Well, thank you folks for joining us. Welcome once again to Grace. I'm going to take you back to the first book of 1 Corinthians today, and we're going to take we could call it a short side trip from our message, our study in the book of Romans, Paul's handbook on faith. And we'll begin by reading the first two verses. Here's where the angst comes into play on some people's part, and where some misinterpretation can come into play. So I think we need to review it again. We'll begin by reading the first two verses, and then we'll cover it a bit more. Cover a bit more of that passage after we explain what's happening here in verses 1 and 2. Paul writes here, "Moreover, brethren," 1 Corinthians 15. Now, before I go further, let me stop. If I ask you, any of you, where would you go in your Bible to show somebody the gospel? Where would you take them? How many would take them to 1 Corinthians 15, verses 1 through 4, where Paul talks about that gospel which he received and passed on to them about how Christ died for our sins according to Scripture and was buried and rose again the third day according to Scripture? This is the passage that is used primarily by our fundamental pastors who want to take people to an understanding of the gospel. The problem with using this passage to explain the gospel is that this passage doesn't really explain the gospel. It is the gospel. Christ did die for our sins. He was buried. He did rise again. But what happened to the sins he died for? That's the issue. So everybody on every street corner, more or less, is using this passage as the gospel message. And I'm here to tell you that almost everybody believes it. The Catholic Church believes it, the Nazarene Church believes it, the Methodist Church believes it, the Baptist Churches believe it, the Pentecostal Churches believe it, on and on and on, to ad infinitum. But when you say, what happened to the sins he died for? Is God going to charge you with those sins once again? Is God going to bring those sins back off of his son and charge them to unbelievers? If you think that's the case, or if you're continually asking for new forgiveness, for new sins, you've not understood Paul's gospel. And the chances are that you've never gotten beyond 1 Corinthians 15, 1 through 4, and come into 2 Corinthians 5, 18 through 21. So let's look at these two verses, because there are some problems that present themselves on the surface to folks who haven't dug far enough for what's happening in this passage. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 1, Paul writes, "Moreover, brethren, I declare unto you the gospel." This is the good news Paul began with these folks, giving these folks early on. "I declare unto you the gospel which I preached unto you, which also ye have received, and wherein ye stand." Verse 2. "By which also ye are," what? "Saved, if ye keep in memory what I preached unto you, unless ye have believed in vain." Now, you're familiar with this passage. You heard it recently. That lesson began like this. Don't you just hate it when the Apostle Paul uses the word saved and the word if in the very same passage? And heads were nodding. And yes, that's a problem. "By which also ye are saved, if." Here's the problem that comes into play. Why are we returning here for today's lesson? Well, there are basically three different views presented, three different ways that teachers interpret the statement Paul's just made there, especially verse 2. Now, if you were with us last week, you heard one of those interpretations. Now, I'm going to give you all three interpretations in today's message, and for the purpose of us not being confused as to what Paul really has in mind here, in what this passage is talking about. I don't think we need be left guessing as to what Paul had in mind. It's obvious when we study the passage. So let's review the verses once again. I want these verses fresh in your minds before we continue on giving you the views that different folks have presented. "Moreover, brethren, I declare unto you the gospel." We could even say that gospel, because Paul has specificity in mind here. His gospel, the good news he preached about the finished, accomplished work of Jesus Christ, what that accomplished, where our sins are concerned. "I declare unto you the gospel, the good news which I preached unto you, which also ye have received," from Paul, "and wherein ye stand." by which also ye are saved, if ye keep in memory what I preached unto you, unless you've believed in vain. View number one. This is the view that I call salvation gained, salvation lost interpretation. Salvation here depends on a good memory and continuing to believe something that you started out believing. According to some, Paul's talking about those who had at one time believed his gospel. And then for whatever reason, unbeknownst to us, they forgot the message they were originally saved by. And as a result, they were not continuing to believe that same message that they had begun by. Whatever it be, a lapse in their memory bank, or just a decision to abandon what they'd heard earlier. Through that abandonment or through that lapse in memory, for whatever cause again, they forfeited the salvation they had begun with. Now, that view was not presented this past week, so unless somebody's wondering if that was the view presented, no. Again, I call this one the salvation gained, salvation lost interpretation, because that's the idea some have presented in light of Paul's words here, by which also ye are saved if you keep on remembering. This view is the notion that in order to ultimately be saved from your sins, you can't just hear the gospel and believe the gospel. You've got to keep on remembering and believing the gospel, or salvation won't be a reality for you at all. It's almost like, I call that Kodak salvation. It's like it just didn't take. It was developing pretty well, and then something happened, got you off course, and the film started going black again. You don't have your salvation after all. Anyone see a problem with this view? Anyone see a problem with this view? Good. More than a few. I was hoping so. Is it possible, in the light of other passages from the Apostle Paul, to believe Paul's good news as to what Christ's crosswork accomplished for everyone where sins are concerned, and then lose the salvation with which we began? I think you can see the problem of view number one right up front. This interpretation totally ignores the sealing ministry of the Holy Spirit of God. And you know enough passages there, but we'll give you a couple anyway. We'll look at a couple of those verses so that we might put to rest any notion that interpretation is the correct interpretation of Paul's by which ye are saved if statement. What happens the instant a person takes God at his word, through Paul, of course, concerning the fact that it was Christ's crosswork that accomplished the satisfaction of God's justice where the sins of the entire world, their sins included, are concerned? What happens that very instant? Well, yes, according to God's word, instantaneously God seals that person who has believed. He seals that individual so that his salvation can never be lost. Listen to Paul in Ephesians 1:13. Now, understand up front, all the verses of today's lesson, depending on how far we get, may not be on your screen. I did as many as I could in the time I had. Ephesians 1:13, in whom ye also trusted, after that ye heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, in whom also after that ye believed. Now, I have a real problem when people start talking about a head knowledge and a heart knowledge. I don't know about you, but you don't think with your heart, you think with your head. So what is it with a blood pump? What's the difference? What are pastors trying to convey when they talk about a head knowledge and a heart knowledge? Well, what they're trying to convey is some people understand the facts. Some people understand the facts that there was a man who came and died for the sins of the world, but they're not trusting in that for themselves. Maybe he died for someone else's sins. We'll not question that he died for sin. Maybe he rose again, but I don't know about my sins. And so this is why Paul says, in whom also ye also trusted after that ye heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation. So if you want to make a distinction between head knowledge, heart knowledge, please make it there. There isn't any other place to make it. If you want to say head knowledge, that's understanding the facts. Heart knowledge, if you want to use that terminology, which I don't like to use, heart knowledge then, if you're using that terminology, would mean accepting it as true for you. Trusting in it, as Paul puts here. In whom also, after that ye believed, what happened? Ye were sealed with that Holy Spirit of promise. You may break a seal. You may have a seal that can be broken. But God's seal you won't break. Paul continues talking about that seal, which is the Holy Spirit himself, in verse 14. which is the earnest. Now, some of you know about earnest money. When you buy something and you give earnest money, it shows your intention to follow through. Which is the earnest, we could say, which is the guarantee of our inheritance. For how long? Until the redemption of the purchased possession under the praise of his glory. I guess we should be praising the glory of Almighty God who seals a believer the instant he believes. If all we had to do was have someone, perhaps Satan or one of his minions, mess with our memory banks, why, Satan would have it made. Now, discouragement. Discouragement could come your way, and you could think, well, maybe this is all a hoax anyway, and you could go off in a different direction. Thank the Lord you're sealed to the praise of his glory. Drop any notion of Kodak salvation, by the way. Salvation doesn't have to take. It doesn't have to develop properly in order to become true salvation. Salvation, where sins are concerned, was fully accomplished by Jesus Christ at Calvary. And when accepted by the believer, at that very instant, that person is sealed until the day of the redemption of this earthly tent in which we dwell. Heaven forbid, if interpretation number one was correct, and it isn't, that a person believe the gospel and then have a brain injury of some sort, or develop Alzheimer's of all things and cease remembering what he had once believed. What a heyday Satan would have with that, if that was the case. Throw out interpretation number one. It's not talking about having to continue believing or having to continue having in your memory, continue remembering in order to continue to be saved. Just throw that out altogether. Faulty interpretation. Paul's not talking about ceasing to remember or even ceasing to believe and therefore losing a person's salvation. In 2 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 22, Paul said, notice the verb tense there, who hath, past tense, present tense, future tense. Past tense, who hath already is the verb tense there, sealed us and given the earnest or the deposit of the Spirit in our hearts. The Holy Spirit doesn't come in and use some special kind of a brand that we can't see and start putting brands or tattoos or some type of piercings all through our hearts so God knows who are his. The Holy Spirit is the seal. He can grieve, but he can't leave because he's God's seal. He's in you. It's not something you feel or see or sense, not something you can touch or imagine and make believe that happens. It's something that's true. The Bible tells you it's true. So we go back to the Word of God. We see that he seals us, the Holy Spirit's in us, the moment we believe. We just have to take God's word for that. That's called faith. And then in Ephesians 4:30, we read from Paul again, grieve not the Holy Spirit of God, whereby, and Paul repeats himself, ye are sealed. How long again does God's seal last? Unto the day of the redemption of these earthly tents is the idea here. You might not be able to form an ironclad seal when it comes to a seal that you perform, but God does. God's seal is a salvation-proof seal. Nobody's going to take that salvation away from you. You cannot lose it. You didn't get it by being good. You can't lose it by being bad. You didn't get it by continuing to remember something. You're not going to lose it if you forget something. Neither you nor Satan is going to break God's seal once you've accepted for yourself what the Bible tells you Christ accomplished where your sins are concerned.